Okay, there is this sensitive issue that you made the claim that sanctions imposed by Western countries in on Zimbabwe wouldn't really affect the ordinary people, but the people in government. And can you justify that statement, even with what we are seeing, the poverty, the hardship a lot of ordinary Zimbabweans are going through, and the people in government are still enjoying themselves?
Yeah, again, I'm very concerned that we must know the facts. We can interpret the facts differently, make different conclusions, but we must not distort the facts. Mm. There are no sanctions against Zimbabwe. You know, right now, as we speak, trade between Zimbabwe and all the nations of the EU, the United States, North America, Japan, in those commodities that we're still able to produce, is growing. Mm. In 2011, trade between Zimbabwe and the EU grew by 46%. That couldn't happen if the country was under sanctions. There are measures that have been applied against individuals. I was one of those. From March 2002 until November 2008, I was not allowed to come to the UK, to Europe, to France. I couldn't have assets here in Europe. Those measures against those individuals are what I am saying. Do not stop Zimbabwean farmers from producing surplus maize if the systems of agricultural support and production were functioning. I think it is very important for us not to be swayed by propaganda that tells lies.
Yeah, but like recently President Mugabe was giving it to the EU and Britain, and it was like in Zambia. And former President Kaunda was saying that Mugabe is not really the evil, but the Western powers. So what's your take on that?
Well, President Kaunda is a human being. He is entitled to an opinion. He was expressing an opinion. That's not a fact. I can express an opinion about Mugabe.
Well, Julius Malema said, they told me the same thing a few weeks ago, too,
well,
that Mugabe is his hero.
Absolutely.
And for a lot of Africans, Pan-Africanists, they still see Mugabe as the hero because they don't really understand what is happening with Zimbabwean economy.
If you were a Zimbabwean who has no food and used to produce enough food for yourself and to export to other countries, if you were a Zimbabwean whose homestead was burnt during the runoff in 2008, and if you were one of the 200 Zimbabweans who were killed during that runoff, and if you were one of the thousands who had long sleeves, short sleeves, you wouldn't make the conclusion that President Kaunda has made. But if you were judging Mugabe in terms of the history of struggle, 1962 to 1980, 1980 to 1995, you would say Mugabe is a hero of the struggle, and you won't take that away from him. It's a fact.
Yeah, but what happened between 1995 and the present day?
Mugabe changed. He became a dictator. He abused the rights of his citizens. The economy collapsed under his stewardship.
Well, don't you think people in the inner workings, like former colleagues, made him to be what he is?
Look, I don't think we should take the blame game. This is very unfortunate. Mugabe likes to blame other people for his failings and his mistakes. Zimbabwean leaders like to blame other people for their failings. Let us accept that the buck stops with us. We are responsible for our condition. If other people force us to do things that we don't believe in, it's not their fault, it's our fault.
But Dr. Makoni,
that's my take.
Yeah, but personally, you know Mugabe very well, and he's a very intelligent man. But it's like, do you think Mugabe will be swayed by anybody even to do things that are evil?
Look, I know that people were killed in Mugabe's name. Whether it was in Gukurahundi, people's homes were demolished in Mugabe's name in 2005 under Murambatsvina. People were harassed in different ways. And Mugabe has been the chief executive of Zimbabwe Incorporated for 32 years. And if you don't do anything about that, you must accept responsibility for it.
Okay, let's talk about
I don't think we should pussyfoot on this issue of accountability and responsibility. If you can't stand the heat, don't get into the kitchen. If you're not prepared to stand for the right, then don't accept to be a leader. And when wrong is done in your name, do something to correct it. If you don't, we conclude you endorse and you encourage.
Okay, let's talk about Zimbabwean politics. You attempted to challenge the ZANU-PF. In 2008, it was said that you attempted to run in the concurrent parliamentary election as a ZANU-PF candidate for the House of Assembly for the constituency of Makoni Central. But you were barred from standing in the party primary because you submitted your CV too late. And you were disqualified. Was it because you have faced Justice Minister Patrick Chinamasa, or you actually sent in your CV too late to be considered? What actually happened?
I sent my CV in time.
Mm.
It wasn't late.
So then but what happened?
Then I left.
Mm.
There were two processes that were running at the same time. As I told you, I had been involved with other comrades to make change from within. When we left the Extraordinary Congress of December 2007, when the party endorsed Mugabe as its presidential candidate in the 2008 elections, then colleagues and I started thinking about a number of scenarios of staying within or leaving. And it was at the time when we were evaluating those various scenarios that I put my name in for candidate for Makoni East. Mm-hmm. But even before the decision was taken on that, I then decided to leave and I announced I was going to stand as an independent candidate.
Mm. That was like as a presidential candidate of your Mavamba political party in Zimbabwe. Why do you think voters should trust somebody coming from the inner circle of President Robert Mugabe?
Voters should not trust somebody coming from the inner circle of Robert Mugabe, but voters should trust Simba Makoni for what he stands for what he has done, what he is capable of doing, and what he is offering to do for Zimbabwe.
But just like that, you must said, they will still remember all those things
absolutely.
Did in the past.
You know, I was involved in ZANU-PF all my life until I left in 2008. Mm. I am quite proud of what the party did in the struggle for our liberation.
Mm.
I am quite proud of what the party did and my small role in that process in the early years of our independence, the national reconciliation, the stabilization of society, the growth of the economy, health and education, infrastructure development. Those are proud actions. And Mugabe should be proud and should be credited for that. But things changed, my friend. And I think this is very important. Let's not remain stuck in the past. We fought a struggle, we liberated ourselves, we got rid of a minority regime, but that doesn't justify long sleeves, short sleeves in 2008. Merely because we fought and liberated the country doesn't justify that Zimbabweans are now starving in 2012.
But President Mugabe is claiming that Zimbabwe is not really ready for elections, and there has been a struggle, constitutional struggle, between him and the MDC party. And what's your take on that? Do you think Zimbabwe is really ready?
Zimbabweans have been ready for elections for a long time. Zimbabweans want to be rid of this inclusive government. It's paralyzed, it's incompetent, it's inept. It's not solving Zimbabwe's problems, it's compounding Zimbabwe's problems. What is at stake is under what conditions will the elections be held?
Yeah.
Under conditions of intimidation, violence, killings, rapings, then Zimbabweans will not be ready for that. But for free and fair elections, under peaceful conditions, without violence, Zimbabweans have been and will be ready when those conditions prevail.
Okay, I have the story that you only stood against Mugabe because plans to get a replacement for him in the 2007 Special Congress failed, and you were then forced to challenge him by people like the late Solomon Mujuru, who was a heavyweight in the ZANU-PF. And he promised to resign from the party to join you. But do you regret that decision now?
No, I don't. Mm. But again, I think we should communicate correctly.
Mm.
I didn't stand against Mugabe.
Mm.
I didn't stand against Tsvangirai. I stood for the people of Zimbabwe. I was an independent candidate for president of Zimbabwe, not against.
Well, the story was that you were being propped up by people in the ZANU-PF.
I wasn't being propped up by anybody. I was working with other comrades in ZANU-PF.
And
I was propping the idea of change. So were multitudes of other comrades who believed that change was long overdue in the party. Change of direction, change of policy, and also change of some personalities.
Okay, let's talk about Jerome Ojuru. He died in a suspicious fire incident. People are saying Mugabe did it again. What's your take on that?
Well, I don't know what killed General Mujuru, but I can confirm it's public knowledge that he died a horrendous death. It was a mysterious death. Nobody can explain how he died in that manner. I don't know who did it. I don't even know that anybody did it, but I know that it was a terrible, terrible tragedy, not just for the Mujuru family, but for Zimbabwe.
Okay, let's talk about land reform. And you were in that regime when the land reform came into force. What was the rationale behind this policy? Because it affected a lot of people.
It depends on what you are calling this policy. Land invasions and the acquisition of land in a disorderly, violent, and unplanned manner was not the policy of the government of Zimbabwe. The government of Zimbabwe under President Mugabe produced a proposal for what was called Phase 2 Land Reform Program in 1998, which was put to an international conference, and it was adopted and supported by the international community. Unfortunately, that program, including the policies and strategies contained in it, was never implemented because the chaotic invasions then took place.
Yeah, you're talking about the eviction of even the white farmers with large farms and being forced out of Zimbabwe. Was it part of the invasion you're talking about?
No, the invasions were part of what I'm calling the unplanned, chaotic acquisitions.
Yeah, the present generation of Africans still see their leaders as lacking vision. What's your take on that, especially for Zimbabwe?
Look, the condition that Africa is in and has been for a long time, in my view, arises from what I call the failure of leadership. African leaders have failed their people. Africa should be flying. Zimbabwe should be flying. There was a time Zimbabwe was on the uptake. We did not perform. We did not articulate a vision beyond replacing colonial rulers with indigenous rulers. Beyond that, we did not, and up to now, we have not still articulated what do we want Africans and Africa to be in the world. When Thabo Mbeki said, "I'm an African," and he posed the question of the African Renaissance, we missed the golden opportunity. Africa as a whole missed the golden opportunity. It was Mbeki and South African project. It should have been a continental project of equal magnitude, if not even more, bigger, greater magnitude than the liberation struggle. And I remain very pained by the fact that the opportunity of an Africa resurgent, confident, competent, performing on the global scale like an India, like a Brazil, like a China, has been squandered by our lack of leadership.
Okay, let's look at healthcare in Africa. Like even President Mugabe is always going to Singapore for a health check every now and then. And lots of African leaders are dying in hospitals abroad. Yeah. Well, is the situation so bad that even the African leaders don't even believe in the system back home?
Unfortunately so. What a terrible indictment of ourselves. You know, in Zimbabwe, we had among the best health and education facilities, not just when we inherited them at independence, but we improved upon them light years ahead of where they were when Ian Smith was Prime Minister of Rhodesia. But we have destroyed those in a short 10, 15 years to the extent that, unashamedly, my president has to go to seek an eye cataract operation out of the country. We're doing eye cataract operations on ordinary Zimbabweans. They're not good enough for Robert Mugabe.
And what kind of leader do you think Zimbabwe deserves after this after his term in office?
Zimbabweans deserve a world-class 21st century quality leader, comparable to anywhere, comparable to Hu Jintao, comparable to Manmohan Singh, comparable to David Cameron. probably even better than Barack Obama.
But do you see yourself in that mold?
We have people capable of that quality of leadership. I believe I am one of them.
Okay, Dr. Makoni, it's nice to have you on Hot Seat Extra.
It's a pleasure.